On today's podcast, we actually have a special guest, Maurice Clarett.
The Maurice Clarett.
Yes, and he is very inspirational. It's really one of our best episodes so far. So please listen up and enjoy the show.
Welcome to the Startup Addict Podcast. I'm Nick Swinburne. I've been starting companies for over 20 years now. I've had some big successes, like Zappos.com, and lots of failures. Regardless of the outcome, I'm still convinced there's nothing more addicting than trying to turn ideas into reality. Hey, how's it going?
How you doing?
Good. Awesome. Well, thanks for coming on. We're really excited. I've been posting about you on Instagram. I've been saying you got my mind spinning. You're my inspiration right now. So that's pretty awesome.
Says a lot. Thank you.
Every day I see the smiling face at the end of your workout, and I think, fuck, I have no excuse not to do mine now.
Yeah, it's just a personal accomplishment, man. Just to get up off your ass every morning and get moving.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's one of the hardest things for anybody to do. I don't care how rich you are, how poor you are, who you are, just getting over the first part of that day just brings so much confidence and energy and positive momentum to other areas.
Yeah. It's also the accountability. Like, I was you got me thinking, well, shit, maybe the reason I'm not posting is because I don't want to set a precedent, which I won't be accountable for. And people will be like, hey, but you posting every day. I'm like, ugh. I gotta start working out, and I gotta start posting it. Well, yeah. I am working out, but I gotta work out that day. So, it's cool.
Absolutely. So, I went through that for a while. So I would go and stop, and this was a few years back. And just once you start to travel, your routine starts to get in the way, or you just get out of some level of consistency, and you always run into these excuses. But I always ask myself, like, where do these excuses show up in other areas of my life? And so I've put myself out there to hold myself accountable, and literally I call it like some sort of group chat, like just people on Facebook and people on Twitter and other platforms who respond and say, hey, I got my workout in. But it is for accountability, but the biggest part is just for me. It's kind of like me talking to myself. You know, I think I'm it's very easy, you know, to get comfortable or get into another sort of routine. That's an alternative from what I'm doing, and literally it's really me talking to myself, just me forcing myself to get out of like a mental funk.
Yeah. No, you're helping everyone get out of their funk, I think. So I wanted to real quick, there's three parts, three different areas I thought. One, if we could, you know, I know you've talked about it a lot, but I think one is if we got everyone up to speed on the story, because it's an amazing story. So kind of however, it's obviously hard to summarize, but however in depth or quickly you kind of wanted to do that. And then I wanted to, you know, because we're the Startup Addict, really wanted to go into your company and kind of the process of starting that and that experience with the Red Zone. And then just had some general philosophy questions and just like, you know, some questions that, you know, give people a different perspective on how to approach things and that kind of thing. So those were the
three. I would love to.
So,
yep. I would love to. Well, my story begins at Youngstown, obviously. Youngstown, Ohio, just for context purposes. Youngstown, it will remind you of sort of what probably Los Angeles was back in the 80s. You know, very violent, very criminal-ridden. A lot of just like your normal inner-city neighborhoods. To make a long story short, you know, I played sports. Never took them serious, though. It was just something to do as a kid growing up. I obviously got in trouble as a juvenile. I was incarcerated three times. It was on my third time that I was incarcerated. I actually had a male mentor. I was originally supposed to go to the state facility as a juvenile for a year, but the gentleman, his name is Mr. Roland Smith, he interjected and basically told the judge to allow me to basically be mentored by him. And so basically that was the first summer, my eighth grade, transitioning into ninth grade. I was lifting weights and getting into football. Fast forward the story, my freshman year, I started to realize that I was better than guys who were 2 or 3 years my senior. And my sophomore year, you know, got a little bit better, but it was my junior year. And I think that anybody who has any level of success, it's like this this energy of dominance. You know, I felt like I can just dominate everybody, or I can dominate something. And that's when I really start locking into my thoughts to say, hey, maybe I can be the greatest at this sport. And I really internalized it and believed it. And so my junior year, I went out to have a bunch of success. And senior year was pretty much the same. And I won all of the awards from high school. And we got a couple games away from the state championship, but obviously didn't win. And at that time, I transitioned down to Ohio State. Came out as a freshman, still working my tail off. And after the offseason, the preseason of some sorts, I ended up basically becoming the first freshman to start at Ohio State. And so my life really happened after I went out and had a successful first game. And, you know, I ran for about 175 yards and 3 touchdowns. And I went into the stadium as Joe Blow, but came out, you know, obviously Maurice Clarett, the freshman superstar to everybody else. And, you know, coming from Youngstown, there's just really no context for that. You don't know how to you don't know what fame feels like or what power feels like. You know, there's nobody who can prepare you for it, you know, if you've not grown up around it or in it. And so from there, you know, I'm a little bit cuter to the women. You know, when I go out, you know, just to be blunt, you know, everybody wants to have sex with me. Everybody wants to take pictures with me. And being an 18-year-old kid is hard. You know, you're enjoying yourself. You're thinking in your mind that this is what you're supposed to do when you're famous. And you all would understand, but I grew up in the MTV Cribs era, right?
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, you get it, right?
Yeah.
So be real famous, be the celebrity, have a 1,000 women, have 1,000 friends, right? And so I was a baby of that, you know, so I thought that since I was supposed to be famous, that I was supposed to live this, you know, this NFL and big time gangster lifestyle. And, you know, so we had a bunch of fun through the season. And, you know, we obviously won every game and we won the national championship. And obviously there wasn't any monetary value, but I still was famous to everybody. I was still famous towards the local community. And, you know, just to bring even more context to it, LeBron was about 40 minutes away from me. And this is when he's a year younger than me. He was coming up in high school. So in a 13-month period, I had basically won everything as a high school kid. I go to college, I do everything that you can possibly want to do from a collegiate standpoint. And then after our season, you have LeBron, he's on this meteoric rise in high school. And he's like, you know, Reese, you know, let's get together. Let's, you know, let's go to each of his games. You know, Nike's chasing him, Adidas is chasing him, Reebok's chasing him. You know, he's sending 20, 30, 40 pairs of shoes. 50 Cent had just came out, we're on tour 50 Cent and Jay-Z. And some like phenomenal stars. And, you know, to be experiencing that at 19, that was like, you know, that's a lot. You know, school became secondary. And through the course of going into my second year, that's when kind of everything fell apart. And it fell apart by the NCAA coming in and investigating me. They found out that I was accepting illegal benefits. And just to put it in context, I didn't accept anything over than maybe $1,500. You know, it was just the using of cars and other little trivia stuff. Yeah. So it wasn't like it was thousands of dollars exchanged.
Did they ever did they ever warn you about that before?
Yeah, they warn you about it. But you know, as a player, you never think you're going to get caught.
Yeah.
You know, if you use somebody's car or something goes on, you don't think that this will actually become a bad thing. You think that you're just doing, you know, what should be done.
Yeah.
And after that, you know, and this is where the seriousness of my story jumps in. After I got suspended, I never in my life felt depression before. And so this was the first time that I had a set of feelings that I just didn't know how to identify. And so I'm sitting around, I'm wondering why I'm restless, I'm wondering why I can't sleep at night, I wonder why my mind always racing. And I found myself being up 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning. And through the process of this, I didn't realize that I had created so many bad habits from going out, right? So the alternative to wanting to feel bad is to feel good. So you go out, you drink, you go out, you drug, you go out just to get away from what you're doing. And so I was in Vegas at a Felix Trinidad fight or something. And no matter of fact, it was a Roy Jones Jr. fight. And I saw Jim Brown at Hollywood Casino or wherever he was at. And this was like 2 or 3 in the morning. He was like, my man, you know, you need to get yourself together. And so initially he was like, come out to LA and get with me, because he was running a program called AmeriCan. And so I got to LA, and to my surprise, the culture was totally different. It was totally cool to be fucked up all day and fucked up all night, party all day, Monday through Sunday. And so that was like very new to me, just basically coming from Ohio. So after that, I came to LA and I hooked up with Jim Brown, and he was trying to put some structure in my life, but I kind of resisted it. And basically I was just out there on my own. You know, I was just out there living, enjoying myself and having fun, and just basically avoiding everything that was going on in Ohio. And so I set out for 2 years. I came back to the NFL Combine, which is February of 2005. And after that, I ended up going to the Denver Broncos. I was in no condition to basically be a professional athlete. I was just basically coming to the team, just going through the motions. And at that time, they tried to sit me down with a sports psychologist and other guys on the team who would mentor me. But what ended up happening was I was just pushing away my help. Mm-hmm. And the initial part was just me pushing them away, because I didn't, like, from a sports psychologist standpoint, I didn't understand that, you know, I can exchange information with somebody and get better. It was just, it was basically, you know, she's white, I'm black, you know, what can she tell me as this young guy from the inner city? Mm-hmm. So hopefully I'm not talking too much.
No, that's not great at all. That's an awesome story.
And after that, you know, I started to get slightly better, but I just wasn't a professional, and I didn't want any of the resources that basically the team had offered to me. So I go out here. This is in 2006 in the fall. We go out, we play the Indianapolis Colts. And after the game, they basically dismissed me. They say, hey, you know, we tried to, you know, throw some interventions in here, try to help you, but you basically don't want any help. And so from there, fast forward the story. I go back to California. I'm a lot more depressed than I can feel it. I remember we went to a party on Sunset. And I was in the party, and what should have been a good time, you know, I had smoked some weed and I had drank before I got there, and I just felt numb towards the entire situation. And at that point, I was like, yo, my mind's messed up. I can just tell, like, I just felt like very out of tune with myself. And I called Coach Trussell, who was the head coach of Ohio State at the time. I called him up and said, you know, Coach Truss, you know, I'm lost. You know, that was the first time that I admitted that I was just lost in life. Like, my feet just didn't have any solid ground to kind of land on. And I went from there to Ohio. And when I got back to Ohio, my lady at the time was finishing up school. And so I was able to kind of like hide out in her place away from the entire world, because I was embarrassed about my situation. And so from there, just from not having any income, not really having any wherewithal about academia, not having any goals or aspirations, I got back into the streets. And so from there, I'm hustling. I'm selling weed. I'm selling dope. I'm in the streets moving 1,000,000 miles an hour. And just through the wins and losses of the streets, and from being in the streets, I ended up committing a robbery case in downtown Columbus. This was December 31st, 2005. A few weeks after that, I found out my lady's pregnant, and you know she's about to have our daughter, which was another bit of stress. And from there, it was just a roller coaster throughout of 2006. So fast forward to August 9th, I get arrested, going on a high speed chase. I get caught with guns and, you know, a bulletproof vest and all of that jazz. And from there, they transport me down to the Franklin County Jail. After they transport me to Franklin County Jail, you know, we go through the initial hearings. And after we go through the initial hearings, the judge says to me, she says, you know, through all this everything, you know, I've seen you play football. I've seen you have some success. You should go get a real psychiatric evaluation. And so after the evaluation, I got diagnosed with severe anxiety and depression. And from there, she placed the psychiatric evaluation in place, and the physician obviously gave me the meds to basically that I'm on today. And I still take mental health medication right now. But the first 7 months of my incarceration, I think, were the best thing to happen to me. And I spent in a 9x4 cell, spent basically 23 hours of the day, you know, isolated. And this was the first time that I had to actually just look at my life, you know, like how the hell did I get here? And I had no solid or concrete explanation on basically how did I go from the NFL and football and all of this stuff to basically being incarcerated in Columbus, Ohio. So after that, through receiving letters and writing letters and just basically thinking about my life, I think it was a godsend that a person sent me a small book. And every platform I get on, I talk about it. It was a small book by James Allen. It was called As a Man Thinketh. And this was the first time in my life that I had read a book independent from school. But it was teaching me that thoughts were things. And once I learned that thoughts were things, I started to retrace my thoughts and what I thought about myself and what I thought about life. And I identified myself as a gangster. So everything I did was a gangster. And I just wanted to manifest this gangster so bad that I actually did. And I ended up reaping the consequences. I didn't see myself as a footballer, as a professional in any fashion. And so from there, I was actually happy I was in prison because it gave me the platform to learn, like contrary to popular belief. And so I ended up getting transferred to Toledo Correctional Facility. They gave me 7.5 years. And from there, I had a chance to sit down with a gentleman called Keller Conte. He was the warden of the prison. And Mr. Conte actually set me down. He said, "Hey, Maurice, you know, I'm from Sierra Leone. And when guys get in trouble in Africa, in my village that my father used to be in charge of, we will bring them closer to the village, help them learn, and basically send these guys back out to the community." He said, "In America, when you get in trouble, guys throw you away." And from there, what ended up happening was that he sent me and put me in a bunch of psychological, social, and emotional rehabilitative courses where you worked on anger management, responsible adult culture, different addiction issues and family issues. And just through the 18 months of going through that, this was just information that I never had basically turned on in my brain. There was another thing that happened to me. There was this thing called Bargain Books. And Bargain Books actually was a wholesale book company where they sold books for a third of the price. And I just always knew if I wanted to be great at something, I should just basically learn from great people and basically read from great people. So I just got on a tangent where I just read from great stories. I start reading about business, entrepreneurship, or anybody who was just massively successful. I said, this is the only information I'm going to consume. And from there, man, I just got excited about learning. Probably motored through 300-400 books. And that's where my aspirations for learning and words and dreaming and visualizing. And I started to really understand it as an adult. I ended up facilitating some of the courses, and eventually after 4 years, they let me out. From there, I ended up going to Omaha, Nebraska to play in a minor league football team. And once I was out there for a couple of years, I do believe in the law of attraction, or actually this is just a cool story and I think it'd be fitting for the platform. When I was in Omaha, I remember I read from Warren Buffett so much. You know, I would read his dude's life up and down, internalize it. And really, I taught myself. I didn't teach myself very efficiently, but I understood the concept of value investing and how he became what he is. And so our coach was actually Joe Moglia. And Joe Moglia was obviously the CEO for TD Ameritrade for about 8 years. And I made hundreds of millions with Ameritrade. He had basically transcended and became the chairman of the board. But after that, he wanted to get into coaching football, which was very odd to me. I was like, you know, who makes all this fucking money then wants to get into coaching football? And from there, you know, every day or every Wednesday, he would hold these small sessions on financial literacy to basically athletes, because, you know, the athletes don't have the platform where they get this information and they have, a shit ton of money. And so out of everybody he offered this thing to, only two people showed up, me and another guy. And these guys, they didn't get the value of basically who they're around. And so he was like, you know what, you know, to hell hosting his class, come with me to the golf course. And so I came to him the golf course. I told him about my life in the clubhouse. And I said, man, I'm very fascinated with Warren Buffett. You know, could you introduce me to him, right? And he was like, you know, me and Warren Buffett are friends, right? And I was like, yeah, no shit, right? So I thought that was like, that's a cool fucking what are the friend odds? To have, right?
Yeah.
So I just thought he was bullshit. And I'm 18 months released from prison. And I was walking through my apartment one day, and I get a phone call, and he was like, hello, can I speak to Maurice? And he was like, it's Warren. And I was like, what the fuck? You know what I'm saying? And I knew he wasn't bullshit because, you know, I heard his voice before. He was on Charlie Rose 1,000 times. And what ended up happening was he invited me down to the office, and as fate would have it, the gentleman who was supposed to meet with him had canceled. He said, hey, you know, do you want to hang out for an afternoon? And I was like, fuck yeah, hang out. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, we go up to the Keywood building, we get in the office, and I just thought it was a cool experience, you know, sit with him for about 4 or 5 hours. And I was just asking any and everything, but, you know, he's a cool guy. But fast forward from there, I ended up coming back to Ohio in 2013. The league had shut down. You know, I was barely making it. You know, I was, you know, I was training guys in the gym. I had aspirations of doing things from an entrepreneurial standpoint, but I just didn't have any money. So I was doing anything to make money to basically eventually fund what it was that I wanted to do. So I came back to Ohio, and ESPN had reached out to me. They said, hey, we would like to do a 30 for 30 on you. And I didn't even know what a 30 for 30 was at the time. And so from there, they do the 30 for 30. They shoot the film for about 8 months. We ended up traveling the the country, from all the places that I have been. And from there, we ended up going to basically showed a film in New York. And after that, I woke up one day and I had about 1,100 emails in my inbox and people requesting me to speak. Never had spoke before prior to that. And so literally just got on the road to start speaking because I had to make a living for myself. Through the process of doing that, ended up making some money. But I got beat up real bad. If anybody ever been on a roll, you know, days at a time, it's just fucking grueling sometimes, airports to hotels and all that stuff. And so, but it also felt like I was incarcerated too, because I was away from my family. I was always by myself. And I was just shopping, going from one place to another. And then after a while, the story just, I just didn't have any feeling to it towards the more. It just felt like I was like repeating words and shit.
Yeah.
And so I ended up getting into initially transportation and packaging, right? And transportation was like very easy to understand. I knew they paid you with a check at the end of the week. And I knew that I can get guys to employ them and basically get them on the roads. And also I learned about packaging and I leveraged it with getting a minority business enterprise certificate. And I knew that we had Cardinal Health here in Ohio, and I started leveraging my social capital, my business certificate. I got some couple partners to become a vendor for Cardinal Health, and I just basically start running trucks. But through the process of doing that, even when I was doing it, it just still felt like I was just doing something, and it didn't feel cool. I was making money, but it just like felt like something rather than something that I really wanted to be involved in. And basically what I'm into now kind of came as a godsend. I went to Toledo, Ohio, the irony of the place that I basically got locked up in, and I was speaking to some students. And after I was speaking to the students, a gentleman had called me over to do a breakout session with the athletes after we were breaking out. And after we got done, a gentleman said, hey, you know, could you come through and watch these courses I'm trying to teach these kids? So what he started going through was this thing called cognitive behavioral therapy. It was the AMBC, the activating event, the mind activity, the body reaction, and the consequence. And these were just things that I basically learned in prison as techniques to process information. And I knew how beneficial it was to me. So I was like, man, if more people knew about this shit, this would basically be of some benefit, because we learned this in prison and I taught it in prison. But I was asking him, how did you basically learn this information and decide to bring it to these people? And so he told me what a behavioral health agency was at the time. And I didn't know what a behavioral health agency was or a treatment center was at the time. And when he started to talk about it, I was like, man, this is the shit that I definitely are directly benefited from in prison. And so after that, I ended up going to some consultants. I Googled some consultings on how you basically open this facility up. I sat through about 8 months of policies and procedures and understanding what a facility was, what it was all about, how do you integrate or engage with these services. And being that I basically take mental health medication and basically I've had addiction problems in the past, I said, man, this is something that I really can get excited about. I want to connect to and just a spectrum of people that you can assist and help with and things that I really want to be involved with. This is what I can do. And so basically that kind of lands the story into what I'm doing now. And I just kind of wanted to give the backstory and let you all take it from here.
Wow. That's such a story.
No, it's
a
lot. Yeah,
it's so yeah, crazy.
It's an awesome story, and no matter how many times you hear you talk about it, it's just as captivating each time. And I like what I like is that you're the way you deliver it is just normal talking, right? I mean, I actually spit my coffee up the other day when during Business and Biceps when you guys were talking about how the baby comes out. I was just like, what the? I was like, driving. I was like, but no, it's amazing because if you didn't go into all the detail of like, you know, but in theory at Ohio State, you could say that the school let you down, right? And it's like when I was trying to think of how it relates to startups, you got a lot of people that are in companies that A, either feel entitled to something, and then
yes,
they have a hard time with that, and then they kind of resent the company when it didn't work out, or they join a company and then they realize, they start daydreaming of these stock options are going to be worth X, and then that doesn't work out, but they stay, and there's nothing keeping them there, but they feel like they're trapped, or they get stuck where they're like, I got so much potential, and then they've got a boss who's threatened by them. And so the boss is like, you know, in their way or doesn't support them as much as they need because he's got his own motivation that they won't surpass him. So there's always all these, like, I rewatched the video last night the 30 for 30. And I was like, man, there's so many parallels where, and obviously what you've been through in the story is on such a greater level, like the depth of the experiences and the impact you're making in people's lives, and versus just talking about working at a company and being stuck. But I thought it's all, there's stuff people can learn from all of it. It's basically a story of like, you work your ass off, you get somewhere, and correct me if I'm wrong, but this is how I took it. You work your ass off, you get somewhere, you get there, you feel a sense of accomplishment combined, and you get excited about that combined with like the fact that you've gotten there has threatened other people. And so now everyone's not as supportive and not as interested in pushing you forward as they could be.
Yep.
So then that doesn't work out. So you have every right to completely resent the situation, be angry. If anyone should feel entitled to special treatment, it would be you within the context of that situation. Like you just lead them to the national championship. Like you've made them a bunch of money. You've exceeded all their expectations.
Yes.
But it's still, then there's the whole, it's not just about, it's not, you know, working a job's not all performance based, because there's politics and relationships and, you know, the people that didn't want to see you succeed before the season started, they enjoy your success while you're succeeding, but then afterwards, they're still a little like subconsciously not thrilled about it. So then at the first chance, they can kind of like pile on and it's almost like they revert to how it was before.
Yeah, so I'll tell you, this was it's interesting for you to even have that level of awareness, right? So you would have people who would be happy for me to be successful, but they didn't want me to be the face of the franchise. You know, we want your accolades, we want your physical ability, we want your attitude, we want what you bring to the company, but you're not what we commercially want to push forward. And you know, and then you dig into something that's totally separate from the podcast and in the origin of this. But it's okay to get these guys out the hood, but it's not okay to display them or put them on the forefront. And that goes for, you know, professional franchises and amateur franchises. And I understand that there's a process of development that has to go on that guys just don't get when you come from backgrounds that demand you to be in a survival mentality. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's almost like the survival mentality is what put you or got you into the situation. You know, so it makes you hungry and gets you out of the neighborhood. And it's what you carry onto the field. It's what you carry onto the court. And you use that, or you harness that energy at some level of motivation, right? Even now to this day, things experienced as a child compiled with things experienced as a prisoner. It's what drives me. It's what motivates me. You know what I'm saying? And having the intellectual skill to grow or to develop or having a platform for people to help you develop it and to mature as a man, I can't say that's always at the forefront of these institutions. And, you know, when you think about it, athletes are some of the most notable people from their communities, right? Mm-hmm. So you're talking about, you know, the NBA, the NFL, all these people. These are the most highly recognized people from these places. And so I just think, you know, from a different perspective, that there should be more of a responsibility with these professional platforms who get millions from these people to develop these athletes to be more influential with inside the neighborhoods that they come from, not just dropping off gift baskets and shit, right? Yeah. And I think that's one of the things now that I do. That's the purpose of educating myself. That's the purpose, excuse me, of talking to kids and say, you know, these are books that helped to change my life. These are books that changed my mind. I know I'm getting off a track or off road, but, you know, one of my greatest examples, I used to tell people that it's a lot easier to be Dan Gilbert than it is to be LeBron James. You know what I'm saying? And for people to come from where I come from, it's hard for them to conceive that, right? They all think that they're going to hit the genetic lottery and they think that they'll be 6'8", and, you know, so somebody will come and swoop them up. But I think just from being from where we're from and having the influence over a population of people, you're talking about changing the trajectory or the mindset of people, I think is just highly important. So I don't know what that had to do with anything, but I wanted to make sure that I got it out.
I think that's why I relate to you. We both end a lot of sentences with that. Yeah. I don't know where that went, but I can never remember the original question. The other thing that struck me was, and I'm just kind of off track too, just thinking of things, but like you know, everyone that goes to college, well, I shouldn't say everyone, but I think everyone is lost, right? And like, it's the time where you're trying to figure out what the hell they're doing, how to survive in the world, how to do all this. And it, when you were talking, it struck me as like, if I look back to myself in college, just getting wasted half the time, barely, you know, like doing enough to get through school. Fortunate because I had, my parents were paying for my school, right? So I was at no risk of like, you know, I might have to get a job for spending money, but I was at no risk of like, if I, you know, if I fuck up, what's going to happen? I had a safety net, which, you know, I'm thankful for, or I was fortunate to have, you know, has pros and cons to that. But what's weird is like, but college is basically set up to kind of, I always thought of it as like, you get in there and now you're there. You just do X, Y, and Z and you can stay there. You can go through the periods of not figuring it out, but it's almost like college supports you for those years where it gives, yes, you something to do. And then what's crazy is your situation or athletes, it's like, there's so much conversation about it's unfair. The athletes like, or do whatever they want. They're at an advantage, this, that, and the other. They shouldn't be able, you know, they're already getting so many benefits. They shouldn't be able to, you know, work or be paid or these kind of things. But then the reality is like, it did the exact opposite for you. Like, it didn't let you just be and learn and then get you through it. And you gave more to the college than, you know, it's just, it let some fucked up kid from somewhere who just came along and just drank his way through college, barely went to class. The college was perfectly content with that. They're like, oh, that's cool. Yeah, that's just, you know, you'll figure it out. And in the end, you'll graduate. And so it's just, it's kind of like, it's frustrating in a way to look at it. Because a lot of stuff to me, right? I when I was watching the 30-30 again, I was like, I start to remember a lot of the stuff, but it's true. You don't know the people, right? I see 13 and that's like, okay. And then I'm just like, holy shit, this guy's amazing. But like, I'm getting completely off track. What's crazy is you had 100,000 people cheering your name and like on the cover of Sports Illustrated, all these magazines. But that was like basically your jersey. You yes, inside that jersey was on the cover, right? So that's like the pinnacle. But then there's not many people. In fact, I can't really think like football players are generally hidden by the helmet and the jersey, and you just see the football persona. But now it's crazy that now you, the person, have gotten like, you're getting the same level of like accolades and like, wow, this guy's got, you know, more inside of him than he had on the field. And on the field, he had one of the, you know, greatest seasons. It's crazy. So it's, yeah, that's the whole amazing part to me is like, and I'm just, you know, I'm stating the obvious, which I tend to do, but it's just like, from listening to your story the first time and then listening to you more on the Business and Biceps podcast, it's, I can't think of anyone that had that level of success. Then, you know, however you look at it, like combination of, you know, mistakes and getting kind of screwed by the system, and then comes out much better for it, and seemingly has no, I don't know, I don't understand how you've come out so so positive and like impacting so many people, you know. And you guys always talk on the thing like, oh, it's not a black or a white thing, it's a socioeconomic thing, or it's a this thing. And I'm thinking, no, it's just a people thing. Like the you know, everything's the same, it's just different circumstances. So like, I look at it as like, not everything's the same, but everyone can relate to it in the same way, right? There's less,
yes,
like I was surprised sitting there telling Corey, I was like, shit, I'm learning things. And I'm feeling like, I was actually, when I was preparing my questions and notes for the call, I was like, fuck, like I don't really have anything deep. I'm not deep. I don't have any, like, you know, I feel like, I don't know how to ask these questions. Like, I don't, you know, like you're much more, the way you articulate things is really interesting. But, yeah, I think that whole college thing of like, it supports the kids that are providing no benefit to the community or the school as a whole. And then it just churns out the kids that are, you know, almost have a job for the school. It's just kind of it's really upside down.
Yeah, I mean, I have, like I said, I have opinions on it, and until you go to Indianapolis and you talk to the NCAA directly, we'll be talking in circles. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And there's about, I think it's about 17 guys who control the whole collegiate system. And there's some sort of nepotism that takes place, I believe, within that culture, that you have to be on like the committee for so many years. And, you know, it's not going to change. The only thing that changes the college system, and this is not to be radical, but it's when the kids just say, we're going to stop. Right. And when you stop money in anything, that's when people pay attention. Right. It's not going to be until you can just get all kids and say, but for kids to understand what they're stopping. Right. And for kids to understand the revenue that's generated, and for kids to understand the money through TV and all of the other spaces that revenue is generated off the backs of them. And let me just put this in context. There will be a fair exchange with these colleges if the kids were adequately educated, right? So if these kids were going and being educated, and the education has some value, then I can say, okay, man, you got a real education, right? But when you go to academic advisors and academic specialists, right? And I noticed, because I've been to over 60 universities, right? And I'll take Ohio State, for instance, right? You need a 31 to get in, right? So if you're an athlete, you don't have to get a 31 on your ACT to get in. If you get an 18 and pass, you're allowed to come to the university. Now, when you come to the university, there's no fucking classes set up for you. You know, we don't have anything here for you, because this is not that type of institution. And so now we put you in officiating golf, officiating softball, women's studies, and all of these bullshit classes. And so if we wanted to have an honest conversation and say, hey, yes, these guys may need those classes to stay eligible, but please remember, this guy may have kids, this guy may grow up to be like to be somebody another day. Can we please get him reading from an eighth grade level at least to a 12th grade level? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Can we work on the academia from the person? You know, even when I was down in Louisiana and I was talking to Les Miles, these are serious conversations, right? Excuse me, you know, would you put your kids in the same classes that you put your star players in? And the answer is a fucking emphatical no, right? Because you know that this does nothing for family, does nothing for community, it does nothing to build this person. But then again, believe and understand that this person will go back to an environment and be influential over somebody, right? And that's why you see so many guys, you know, once they're done playing basketball or football or any professional sport, all these guys can do is fucking run camps. You know, and camps and training is fucking oversaturated, but systemically it does nothing for people, right? Yeah. Black kids and fucking white kids who come from the hood, they don't need to learn how to play sports. They already got that shit, right? They'll learn over a period of time, but it becomes oversaturated with that shit. And so that's that. But for my personal reason, I was bitter initially at the entire situation. And I think that's what caused me to abuse so much, you know, abuse and alter your feelings, right? Nobody wants to deal with any negative emotion, right? You have a negative emotion or you feel tired. There's a fucking beer at this stop. There's wine. There's everything, you know, everything to fucking alter your mood, right? And so I didn't realize that, you know, which was something that was recreational would become something, you know, that would burden me over a period of time. And so what happened was, you know, all of that isolation and all of that self-development and personal development and understanding like the anatomy of forgiveness, understanding how to humble myself, you know, accepting responsibility and the role that I play. You know, you may look at it as a school did me wrong. I look at it as, if I never put myself in that situation, I would have never given them the chance to do it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And just like never putting myself in a situation where I don't have to experience, you know, unfavorable circumstances. And so from there, it was all about just empowerment, right? And I used all of the shit talking people have from me, the look at hims, and took all of that shit, that energy, right? Because it's all energy. But you can take all the fucking negative energy, you can use it to catapult you, right? If you really just focus and concentrate, right? And so I take that shit, internalize it, and use it for myself, right? And so it becomes like my little burning fuel when all the shit talking happened to me, right? And so from there, I said, I'm gonna make myself a better fucking person. But then when I was incarcerated, I would see so many guys say, hey, man, you're only going to be successful because you can get out and play football. So then I had another motivation to become successful in business just because I believe it was possible, right? So you read from fucking, I think stories are the greatest shit in the world, right? If I can do something for recreation, I would do film, but only documentaries on people who fucking overcame shit, right? Mm-hmm. We have filmmaking for all types of bullshit, but just basic fucking human stories of people being able to endure shit, right? Just how did you endure some shit that makes other people quit? Like, you know, when I look at people who are on drugs or people who are, you know, working jobs that they don't want to, like subconsciously somewhere, they said, fuck it, I quit, I give up. You know what I'm saying? And then you become like a bitch for the rest of your life, just bitching at every fucking turn. And so I said to myself, like, I'm just never going to fucking give up on myself. And it just internalized it, held it to be true. And, you know, no matter what I'm going through, that's what fucking drives me. Just like, I'm going to just become all I can fucking be. And I had to, like, challenge myself, like, you know, this energy or motivation that you have, you know, can you put this on a different platform in business to just fucking learn? Like, I think people can learn anything that they want to if you focus and like, you know, get into it. And I just start reading, man, and that's what happened. And I gave all that shit up. And I just say, you know what, that shit causes me to be sick. It causes me to be mentally unhealthy. Like, I get, like, you know, if I get caught up into it, I'll get angry at Andy Geiger. I get angry at everybody and just nothing happens. Or I'll say, you know what, just go ahead and be fucking successful. And that'd be the biggest revenge that you can get at anybody. But also, I can serve as some benefit to people and my family and just feel better about my fucking life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I had a quick question. What would you say to like kids that are actually in school right now, or let's say athletes that are playing, that are taking those courses? What type of advice would you give that to those kids and even the parents of those kids? That
yeah, I mean, to the kid, first of all, the first thing I said to the kid, like, one, they have to be taking those classes because most guys come from low performing school districts where they can't like take other classes, right? Mm-hmm. But the conversation has to happen with their academic advisor, and there has to be some level of vulnerability to say, hey, man, I can't read and comprehend very well. And in comprehension and reading and just even discovering like what skill, having a platform to discover what your skill sets are, right? I think more people need to open that up and say, okay, what am I good at outside of this sport and where does this land me at? You know, so to have those discussions and to create those opportunities, rather amongst alumni or just business owners in general. All these universities have a shit ton of alumni who own small businesses, have opportunities that these guys can tap into. And I think that needs to be a conversation. From a parent standpoint, you know, I'm not sure. You know, I don't really have a solid answer for that. Mm-hmm.
What about someone inside a company, right? It's not obviously not as the same situation, but what if they, you know, I feel like half the people that work are like, feel like they're kind of, they voluntarily took a job, but they kind of feel like they're stuck, right? Like they're stuck.
Yes.
They're either not, they don't have the opportunity, or they're not getting, you know, they're not the favorite. Or, I mean, I worked for the Padres my first job out of college, and I decided in all my wisdom that, that there was no opportunity there and I should leave, because I figured, you know, and it was basically, I decided there was no opportunity there, but I also bombed an interview because I didn't prepare for it at all, which, if I would have prepared for that interview, then there would have been opportunity. Obviously, you know, I think everything happens for, you know, for a reason. But what would your advice be to someone who's stuck at a, they got a good job, but they're not that happy, and they feel like they're just stuck?
Oh, man, at a job, I mean, that's fairly easy for me. And this probably be a two-part answer. I think most people are scared, right? And I'm pretty sure you've heard it before. I'm pretty sure you identified. But people are afraid to just be out there on their own and chase whatever the fuck it is that they want, right? So the security blanket is to come and exist in somebody else's company and just kind of hang out. And just my advice would be to them, obviously you have bills to take care of, you have a family to take care of, a mortgage to pay, rent to pay, whatever it is that you do. I would obviously, and this is my advice all the time, is to continue to work that situation, but figure it out what it is that you want to do. I think if you went around, I don't even know what, if you're in the office right now, but I can guarantee you go to your local business, right, or another business and ask people what they want. People don't even know what they fucking want, right? And I found that out in life. If you go ask somebody, what do you want to do right now? Just lead by saying this: in a perfect world, what would you be doing right now, right? And most people couldn't tell you. I would guarantee you 8 out of 10 people couldn't tell you. And then even if you said, even if they could tell you and you ask them, what are you doing to do it? They're not committed. right? So people just like have no fucking level of commitment. That's a societal thing, man. And it's just a bunch of shit talking. And like I said earlier, people fucking give up on themselves, or they give up on their dreams because it didn't happen by, you know, 25 or 26 or 30 or 31, and they can't endure fucking pain. The pain of, you know, I'm struggling for a couple of years. The pain of, I may have to downsize my house or my apartment. The pain of, I have to build this fucking business from the ground up. Or the pain that I have to make a decision, and in the process of making this decision, I may be fucking wrong about some shit. People don't want to go through that shit, but that's the path to kind of find yourself. I think everybody, like, has, and I don't want to say just a gift, but everybody has a skill set that they can basically monetize, right? But the process of figuring that out, it's fucking painful. You lose a lot of money doing it. You lose a lot of money learning. You lose opportunity. But the alternative is to go help somebody else build their dreams, which isn't a bad thing, because I fucking employ people to help me build mine every day. But I don't know. I don't know the advice that's all encompassing. But people just got to stop being afraid, man. Yeah. I'm telling you, and fear paralyzes so many fucking people. And, you know, it's not until you go to prison, until you go to a situation where you start to realize that life is not that long, and all you have is your personal happiness and how you feel about yourself, and what's important is the things that you're chasing and what you're accomplishing. I got a new place, and one thing that I enjoy is that I just have trees in my backyard. You know what I'm saying? Different shit makes me happy. You know what I'm saying? And you start to care about just having trees in your fucking backyard rather than other people. Or you enjoy the fucking silence, or my daughter was in here cooking and it was just able for just to walk around and see her enjoy herself. But these are the rewards that don't show up in my bank account. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, but these are the things from following what you believe in and creating the time for yourself that people just don't want to go through. You know what I'm saying? But that's where the motivation to get up in the morning running from. That's where all that shit comes from. And I also think, and I'm just going on my little tangent, just because I got the energy to, right? If I fuck the podcast up, I'm sorry.
No, that's great.
That's awesome.
But I mean, we have a culture of, like, you know, you're talking about employees. Everybody thinks everything needs to feel good, and I think that I don't care if you're on the fucking West Coast, East Coast, Midwest, whatever. Distinguishing what needs to be done from what I feel like doing is like one of the great paralyzers of America. You know, and oftentimes I don't feel like fucking getting up, but I know the results of my life when I do get up and get after it. I don't like fucking reading, but I know the results from it. Nobody likes fucking dieting, but you know the results from it when you actually follow it through. And so when you say make basic commitment and discipline and understand that these are results, okay, you got the fucking Warriors. I'm pretty sure these motherfuckers don't want to go to practice every day. You know what I'm saying? But the routine that's followed produces certain results. And that's what that conversation needs to be had in America. Not the fucking, hey, I got the Lamborghini, look at me, I'm cool and shit. No, that's not business. That's not following your dreams, like the grueling process and you discovering who the fuck you are in the process. I think like people just self-discovery is beautiful. You know what I'm saying? When you start to realize like I fucking have something else inside of me other than, you know, click on the TV for sports or just, I'm just like this bullshit ass person who works the 9 to 5. I go grab a beer, I go home. Life is more than that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I think that if those things became a conversation on different platforms, then, you know, people will become aware that there's other things in life that would, they would have a value. And oh, maybe this is not so bad, me going to chase my dreams, because I can figure out a little bit more about myself. Or maybe me going to chase my dreams allows for my kids to have an opportunity to get out of a cycle that maybe I'm in. You know, maybe if I really trade, like I believe this 100%, like I always say, you know, I'm not a religious person by any facet, right? But I do believe in God. And I don't believe that God gives you what you want. He gives you the opportunity. I think the universe, God, whatever you want to call it, it gives you the opportunity, and that's on you to basically put it together and chase your dreams and do it. Like the personal accountability, the discipline, the diligence, the reading, the accuracy of thinking, the teamwork, all of the intangible stuff that you have to put together. I think that's is what makes us. But I don't know. People don't want that journey. Everybody wants the fucking, you know, the microwave life.
Yeah. I think it's interesting. I think it's like a lot of it's perspective, right? So I look at it as like I was born into a fortunate situation. Like I was lucky. There's no, you know, whenever I've kind of fucked up or lost enthusiasm. There's always been like a something there to kind of keep me going. And I was driving the other day. I actually got emotional. It was weird. I was driving. I saw this guy walking, and he was, I mean, I don't know. He was probably one of those like 400 pound guys, right? He was walking down the side of the road, and you could tell every step hurt, like it, or didn't hurt, but it wasn't comfortable to walk, right?
It was laborious, yeah.
Yeah, and he also, you could tell, was very self-conscious about the fact that he looked like he was laboring down the road, right? But something got him out there to go down the road, and actually, like, it was strange that happened, but I just got kind of like emotional, but not like, I didn't feel bad for him. I just thought, yeah, this guy's a fucking beast. Like, he got himself out of the house, and he's fucking walking down the street, and he's doing what he needs to do to, like, something happened that made him say, I'm, like, physically, this is really hard, and emotionally, this is really hard for me to put myself out here and be judged by everyone that drives by. But he was doing it, right? So I'm thinking to myself, at that point, I was complaining about something fucking stupid, like, oh, this is taking longer, oh, what a pain in the ass, I have to have this conversation. It's like, I was just like, God, I am a fucking pussy. Like, look at this guy. This guy is inspiring to me, right? Now, that guy's walking down the street, and he's sure as hell not thinking he's inspiring people that drive by, right? He's thinking, yeah, like, everyone that drives by is looking at him like, oh, look at this guy. So I think, okay, so that's like, but he was inspiring, but it was like perspective, and part of it was like, you know, you're like proud for him, or, you know, happy for him that he's overcoming so much with each step down the road. And then part of you is like, I don't have it so bad, right? So then I think, like, you, and then I think, okay, you're at Ohio State, but you in jail, you learn more than you, I'm guessing, than you did at Ohio State, right? Because you took the time,
true,
to do it. So I always look at it like, all right, you got someone like me who's basically, you know, any hardships are not hardships on the scale of hardships. And so I sit there, and sometimes it's hard to figure out, like, oh, how am I going to do this? Or when I was in college, I'm calling my parents and passing the burden to them of, like, I'm fucking useless. I don't know what I'm doing. This is bullshit. I don't really want to do it, you know. But then if you, like, so, and I could always compare it to someone else and get a perspective. But there's people who are, I don't know how to phrase it properly, but they're, like, they're in the shittiest situation. So they have, like, the perspective of, like, great, I'm glad that I could be your fucking perspective and makes you feel better, but I don't really have anyone that I can say, I mean, they do, right? So that's where it feels so daunting, is it's like the gym, right? It's like daunting if you know, like, all right, if I go to the gym every day for the next year and a half and I eat right, after I do all that, I'll be like a little, I'll almost be to where I should be. But that's like so many fucking steps in a row, right? So then there's people who come from situations and they realize, shit, I didn't learn what I was supposed to learn. I wasn't taught what I was supposed to be taught. I didn't have the infrastructure around me. But they might want it so bad, and they might know the right thing, but they think, fuck, dude, this was all, the situation I landed in is not built for me to succeed. There's so many, I know I could do it, but there's so many steps. So what would your advice be to them as far as like mapping out each step so that it feels like A, manageable, because it's one small step at a time, but also, like, how do you just not, you know, you're taking 1,000 steps up this mountain, you know it'll be great when you get to the top, but you still got 996 to go, you know, like, that's where I feel like it must be tough for people, where they're like, I got to do so much work just to get to even. You were fucking born in this situation, you went to these schools, they taught you all this shit. I didn't choose where I was born, I didn't choose what school I got put into, I didn't choose what I was taught. And now I got to do so much extra work just to get to even. It, you know, it's not fair, but it's also like it's got to be hard.
But that's that's acceptance and just saying this is my reality.
Yeah.
Right. So I don't get caught up, or I didn't. This is just my thing, and this is my advice. I don't get caught up in looking at the next man, what he has, right? And I feel like, and I've said it on the podcast, I'm not sure if you heard it, but I think that one of the most dangerous things anybody can do and anything is to count another man's money.
Yeah.
And once you start counting other people's money and what they have and what they got going on, I just think you lose focus from yourself. And that's how jealousy and envy and all that stuff. Yeah.
But like, then you got to give up social media. You got to find something to do with yourself all day.
Yeah. But for me, the advice that I would give is, one, I would start, I would step back and just talk about mindset. and your mindset always has to be on you and what you have going on. And I kind of stole that from Warren Buffett. Like, through the process of talking to him over the course, he just was like, you know, if you're that dialed in on what you're supposed to be doing, you didn't have time for, and social media wasn't real big back in, you know, 2011, at least to me it wasn't.
Yeah.
He was just saying, you know, your mind should be on your business, right? He was talking about, he only accept like 7 phone calls, but everything is spent on developing him. And he's like, if it's that important to you, you spend the time basically doing it. And so I kind of like internalized that. And I think that's how I like get out of like those jealousy things, or being in other people's business, or looking at you and say, man, you know, it'd take me a million years to get where Nick's at. You know what I'm saying? I don't even think like that. I don't even let that like doubt come into my mind. Like, as crazy as it may seem, I believe that I will be massively successful just from working my ass off and doing the right things. And I believe that just as much as I believe that I was going to be a good football player. And I think that like confidence and belief, I'm not sure how it's manufactured. But I think like the universe blessed me with it, just to be confident at different times, not all the time, but I've been able to do it. But my advice, and I'm a visualization person. If I walked into my basement right now and showed you the walls, I have nothing but whiteboards and dry erase boards. And I believe that we all are creators of our lives. And literally, if you go back into the book that I was talking about, As a Man Thinketh, everything that we think, we become. Everything manifests itself. Nobody does anything different. I took a bunch of content also from Dr. David Hawkins, Power Versus Force, and they talked about metaphysics and the process of thought and how it basically comes to fruition and how everything is manifested. And I would tell the person, I always suggest to the person to investigate what it is that you're thinking about and get it off of what Nick has, get it off of what somebody else may have. And looking at somebody else who has more than you, obviously, from that perspective, makes you feel smaller, right? You know, we all have somebody who we can look left or right to, no matter how successful everybody is on his phone, that will make us seem small in comparison to what we're doing, if that's what we're valuing. But my life literally got rebuilt from writing it on dry erase boards. I say, okay, I'm trying to get X. And I kept on just doubling and flipping and doubling and flipping and making sure that I was just worried about my business. And so to the person who may be listening, that's the process. It's nothing like, there's no scientific, you know, buy this fucking package, you know, come with me this weekend and spend $20,000. It's really that fucking simple. You know, it's taking the next step to say, hey, this is where I'm going. Excuse me, I'm getting up at fucking 6 a.m. I'm exercising to energize myself. I'm exercising to discipline myself. I'm meditating on where I want to go. I'm believing where I want to go. I'm priming myself up for what I want to do. And I'm fucking totally focused on getting to that. And then once that is got, and then you've had experience and wisdom from that, you just set the next target. And fuck, I'm pretty sure maybe the same in you all's industry. And maybe it's a little bit different on the West Coast, because that's like, you know, Silicon Valley, all that shit is like something totally different. With massive amounts of resources, but that's how it's happened in my life. And I can just only give my advice or how I've seen other people just set small targets. You know, like, how do you reach goals in business? You decide what you wanted to do. You set a task to them. You give a timeline to them. Did you complete it or not? You know what I'm saying? And really just holding yourself to that same basically formula. Here's my task. How will I complete it? What are the steps to complete it? Do I got the fucking discipline to complete it? Did I accomplish it? Yes. Set the next one, and that's just my 2 cents.
What were the first steps when you were starting the Red Zone? Like, when you said, okay, I've got an idea, what were the first, like, what did you have to do to get it going? I think you told us how you got into it, and you obviously, beyond the you know, the learning and the months of all that, like, what were you like, what's step one in starting a business?
Step one for me was just, I think the biggest thing, just believing and seeing where you want to take something. I think that visualizing where you can take something or what you can do with it is what like energizes you. You know, like football players, you want to win a championship. That's what energizes you to lift fucking weights and practice and watch film and all that stuff. And so I was able to be energized on the amount of people who I can deliver information to or deliver assistance to. I think the belief in that thing had to start first. From there, it was identifying just strong people who I basically could basically start the company with, people who were close to me. Obviously, when you're getting ready to start a business, people who are closer to you are the ones who you can basically lean on, because they may believe in you. You don't get the top tier talent, because the top tier talent is at somebody else's company getting paid for what they're doing. And so we legitimately started 4 people in a room. and I knew a target population of people who I wanted to introduce these services to and see what we're doing and basically get that thing going. And the next thing you know, we started from four people, started the services, talked about the help that we were basically administering to people, talked about the purpose of it, and basically just started shopping. And just like you would shop a product, we basically shopped our services to people. I looked at the competitors or other people who were in the industry, and I knew what they weren't doing from a business standpoint. You know, they weren't going to engage with people. They were just basically open their doors up and say, okay, we're here, come in if you want to. So it was real grassroots to me, you know, going to knock on doors, getting neighborhoods, throwing different small events from an adolescent space and raising awareness and consciousness towards mental health assistance, what it was, what it's about, and things of that nature. The other part of that, was that we were engaged with adults who were basically going through drug recovery services and so on and so forth. And so literally I was going to people and just explaining to them what recovery was, how recovery works, what is the process of recovery, what does it look like when guys are trying to get clean and off of drugs and alcohol, and basically just went from there. And so that's kind of how we started. And the further we got out, or the more we got out in public, people just started to hit us up and say, okay, you know, could you come and provide services here? Could you come provide services there? And four people grew to seven. Seven grew to 21. 21 grew to about 80. 80 grew to 100. 100 grew to 150. And we'll probably, you know, grow a little bit more. The trickier thing was just from me and from a business standpoint. If you've ever dealt with anything from a medical standpoint, you understand that different insurance companies pay on different schedules. And just, I had basically, you know, started and I started with a partner, but through the process of growing and understanding your soft costs or understanding the hard costs of onboarding people, understanding, you know, once people get 90 days in, you're adding on insurance, your IT costs and all of that stuff. Learning all the actual business and the numbers and how, you know, your quarterly taxes getting paid, understanding and learning all that was just the strongest learning curve. But these are just things that I've learned just through building our business. And obviously, like I said, we'll grow a little bit more because, you know, we have more revenue coming in and we're able to buy more property, obviously, to expand our business. But that was I don't know if I answered your question, but that's kind of like how we came to this point.
Did you have to? And I don't know if we're running over. If you've got to go,
I don't have to go.
Got to come in.
Okay, I'm
cool.
Just here.
Did you have to raise money, or were you able to fund the business off of like revenue?
Yeah, no. So I had about $250 myself. That was like basically all I had to my name, and I had a partner initially. And so if you've ever been into to get a Medicaid number or to get an insurance number, basically you have to operate for about 10 months solely out of pocket, right? So I damn near went broke, right? I got to the point where I was going through the process. About month eight, my partner dropped off. He said he just couldn't take it anymore. He didn't want to wait for the number. So he said, hey, you know, pay me back once you do finally get your number. And literally I got down to the 10th month and I got down to the, I was like 9 months and probably 15 days. And literally I needed about 40 grand. And I went to a guy and said, hey man, I got all these receivables and we'll get money paid, but I need about 40 grand because I'm literally broke. I had about $129 in my account. And so I felt what it feels like to spend every single dollar that you have into a business and feel the stress and the sleepless nights and all of that shit. And that's what we did. But we initially got checks back on different schedules. I was able to pay him back and get him entirely out the way. Probably paid about probably 300 grand back last year in debt aggressively. I came out of May debt free, and we were able to grow to about 140-150 people, able to you know, grow into some new spaces, go into about five more cities, pay back, you know, the debt that I had, and basically become debt free in about May. So I don't have any partners or anything. And we're just kind of like rocking and rolling now, getting excited. You know, we have a 29,000 square foot facility. They've accepted an offer for the building here in Ohio that will basically increase our revenue probably tenfold just from adding on different services. But that's kind of like my situation right now.
That's awesome. And then you got something?
No, I was just saying that was awesome.
Are you?
No, it's not. No, it's not awesome. I was paying down debt last
year. Well, not the debt part, not awesome, but being
still,
out of debt.
It's still awesome.
you can't say so. So that needs to be a conversation because people believe that revenue is profits, right?
Yeah.
They can't distinguish, and I've been naive, right?
Yeah.
And so you would see checks coming in, and you would have hundreds of thousands of dollars coming in, right? And you know, people even within your company are not understanding that you're servicing a huge amount of debt fast to get it off your back, right? So they'll see checks, they'll see people getting services, they'll see people getting service, and the next thing you know, they'll think that you're like rich. And I was just basically, I had a lot of people, but I wasn't rich by any means, right? Yeah. And just to be blunt, I said on the last podcast, literally up until May, I got out of debt. Before the summertime, we had been slightly overstaffed, right? And so, you know, to lose money after you get out of debt, you know, it was a real thing. But to get things turned around and going back up the right curve, I'm happy. You know, I'm happy this is the first time that, you know, I'll be, you know, debt free from anything and anybody in my entire life. And so I'm just looking at growth and what we can possibly do. But, you know, like we've had challenges just like everybody else. You know, we had before, and I don't know if this makes sense to anybody, but you may have somebody who's in the medical space, the treatment space, the insurance space, so they may get reimbursed. In Ohio, we used to be able to submit all of our claims into one portal, and you would get a check every single week from all insurance companies. Now they've switched the payer system to where you enter your claims into all five portals from insurance companies that provide services or who insure the clients who we provide services to, and now you're paid back on different schedules, right? And so from doing that, you know, now you have to calculate when you pay, you have cash flow problems, you have all this other stuff that comes up, but these are just all legitimate business problems, things that I've either learned on a run or, you know, talk to somebody within the industry and learn myself.
Yeah, it's funny when you say people think revenue. And people think, like, we have a restaurant in the first year and a half. It was losing money, and people would just see a picture of it looking full, and they'd be like, "Oh shit, you're killing it with the restaurant," you know? Or they'd see like, you know, clothing brand, you release like a new collection, and they're like, "Oh, you're killing it with the thing." And it's what I always found is hard is like, where does that conversation go, right? They're like, "Oh, it must be fucking awesome doing the restaurant," and you want to be like, "No, it's not fucking awesome. It's fucking way harder than I thought. It takes up way more time. I'm fucking losing money. This is that. I don't even know if this is. If I could start over, I wouldn't fucking do this again."
And they're asking for a raise.
But then you're like, the person's looking at you like, "Holy shit, dude! I was just saying like, hey, that place looks packed." But it's a weird. And I think that creates the pressures of people. Is like, it's just like, you know, whether it's your wife or your friends or just random people, there's these perceptions of how you're doing, and then there's the reality of like, it's you know, it's on shaky ground. Like, we got to power through this, and it's like hard to figure out how much of that to share, how much of that to keep to yourself. It's tricky.
So but why isn't that like, so that's actual the truth,
yeah,
right? If that's the I always said it's lead with my truth, right? So they say truth has no explanation, right?
Yeah.
I read A Course in Miracles. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists, right? Yeah. So why do I have to feel captive from not leading with the truth and telling these people? So I tell our people like, okay, we're not going to fall. We're not going to fail. But these are the circumstances, right? So for guys like me, like, where can I hop on the fucking internet and hear real shit?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you have to realize there's listeners who would really love to just hear about, and those aren't their vulnerabilities. Those aren't that I miscalculated and misstep.
Yeah.
It's just things aren't working out the way that I would like them to be working out right now, but we're working to that place to get them right. You know what I'm saying? And in that part for me is more beneficial to society in general. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now I can get past the guy who has to put 55 fucking Lamborghinis in a mansion on TV and talk about this is entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
No, that's not entrepreneurship. Working through these sticking points, you know, working through your accounting, working through issues of overstaffing, working through understanding cash flow. That's the stuff that I believe that, I mean, that's the stuff I'm looking for.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like, do you understand the sole reason that I even went on a Business and Biceps podcast was to have access to two dudes who were doing entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
That's it. I didn't even give a fuck about nothing else. I said, look, whatever y'all want to pay me, I'm cool with, but at least I'll get reps and I'll be conditioned around other entrepreneurs who I can talk through real business stuff with, right? So I'm getting therapy and therapeutic services, you know what I'm saying, from people who are around me, different advice. Hey, you know, you should go to a smaller bank for an issue like this. You know, Chase is like saying, fuck you if you don't have over 40 million in your account. Like, it's just certain stuff that you just can't get from Joe Blow down the street at the coffee shop. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. I don't know, for whatever it's worth, from you all having so much success, I think that it's beneficial to younger guys. But then also, you know, when I get connected to people's ears and they realize I can't hear this shit nowhere, yeah. I think that that's what makes the podcast a landing space, because, you know, all of these super successful people who you all may have some access to, when you start getting into the operational components, that's like, okay, now I can go on the fucking title, click it, listen to it while I'm fucking running around the track. I can have something of value. And I just think that that's like, you know, fuck, why do you buy Levi's? It's a fucking good denim company. It's a good jean. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
What makes up American companies? Like, truthful shit. You know what I'm saying? Real shit. Real shit is always going to be real shit. That's my two cents.
Yeah. I think I've learned more from podcasts. I probably didn't start listening to podcasts until 2017, but I think I've learned more from those than I've learned from anything else. Yeah. When we started this podcast, we were going to just a big part of it was going to be discussing the day-to-day issues that we're facing in a couple of businesses. But then, yeah, we got to do a better job of that. You're giving us another kick in the ass here.
Asking.
Because it's, you know, you start overthinking it a little bit. Well, you start thinking, well, this would be interesting for a listener, but how's the employee listening going to take to that? Or, you know, or this is going to distract people from the mission at hand. And we are just kind of being wussies.
But then you're assuming, you all become assumers, right?
Yeah.
You're assuming what they may be, but fuck them, right? Yeah. Not in a bad way, but if I'm leading with my truth, if I'm leading from what I'm really going through, like, okay, I give you who I stole this from, right? I was watching a show. So I think Charlie Rose is one of the coolest guys to interview. I think he just interviews very well, or he provokes thought. And I was watching the interview in prison from Denzel. And he said, you know, guys come to Hollywood, they act like, what separates you from anything? And he was like, I don't think nothing separates me. But he said, I think that I understand one thing. He says, from the specific comes the universal, right? And so he said, if I can tap into my truth and tap into things specific to me, he said, I think everybody universally feels these things, right? Just emotions and feelings and everything else. And so what you may assume that a person may receive differently, an employee who may work for you or whatever, that may motivate them, right? You're thinking from a pessimistic standpoint, like, people can only correct what they deal with, right? So if certain parts of my business suck, right, you owe it to them to be honest with them, to basically say, you're not performing very well. But that's an honest conversation that allows you to get better. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know, whatever that's worth, but that's just my two cents on it.
Yeah, no, we did an episode, I don't know, was it last, well, I don't even know what day is today, Friday? Was it?
Regret?
The one, we did one where you were saying, I think on Instagram, like, you know, it helps to just say I'm a bad motherfucker when you're doing things, right? And we had two parts about it. One, it just didn't sound that cool when I said it. It sounds, we were talking about how, it sounds better in your head. When you're giving yourself a fucking pep talk in the mirror, you just sound like, it sounds perfect. And then it comes out loud. For me, it's like, I'm a bad motherfucker. So then, two, I was like, we started talking about what we each say to ourselves. And I've, up to that point, I'd always said, on a daily basis, I get up in the morning, I look in the mirror, and I go, I'm not a fucking pussy, right? I'm at the gym, I'm feeling tired, no one's looking at me, but I tell myself they're all watching me, and that I'm not a fucking pussy. I don't want them to see me. I gotta keep going, right? So we realized, or I realized in the last episode, was it last week or have we posted yet, or is it today's?
Last week.
We were talking about you, and I said, what made me realize is, like, I'm sitting here, my goal is not to be a fucking pussy. Like, that's like, there's nothing forward thinking about that. I'm basically just saying, I don't want to be negative, right? I want to be not something, which basically puts me at like zero. I'm going to shift today to, instead of being like, I don't want to be a pussy, I'm going to sit in the mirror and I'm going to say, like, I'm a bad motherfucker, and see. And that's different, because now I'm pushing forward. So we had a conversation about what I should say, and nothing was good. But even if you just sit there and say, I'm the man, like, or something, when I saw your post, it just triggered psychological, oh, wait a minute. Yeah, there's a big difference between saying, I'm not going to be this, or I'm going to be that. And it's the same thing with sharing about the business. Is my, like, it's hard to be like, even psychologically within the companies, we're like, hey, because we're starting a new company or a couple of new things going on. It's like, hey, from day one, we got to be willing to say, like, we're going to be really fucking good at this. We're going to be the best company in this space. My nature is more to be like, not like, like self-deprecating or just like, I don't know what it is. It's not on purpose. It's not like to seem cool or anything. It's more just there's something where you're not willing to put your foot down and say, no, we're going to be really fucking good at this. It's more like, ah, we'll figure it out. You know, maybe it's going to be hard, but
no, but you have to say it, because that's what brings accountability.
Yeah.
But look how that mentality goes back to when we first got on the podcast. You said, I don't post everything because it holds me accountable.
Yeah.
So even though you're successful, you still have you're successful financially, but you still have an issue with accountability.
Yeah.
Right. You still have an issue with claiming what you want to be. So me, I have no problem claiming what I want to be.
Yeah.
I have zero fucking issue. This is what I am. This is what I'm going to do. This is who I am. And I'm willing to put myself out there. Right.
Yeah.
But what that does to look how that affects your people. If I tell them we're going to be the fucking best, how you think they're going to wake up and work and walk and talk and display themselves?
Yeah.
But if the leader of our crew, if we get ready to go into prison fight, and you say, I hope I don't get fucked up, I don't want to fight with you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It just is what it is. Yeah. I want to hear like, man, we're about to smash these motherfuckers. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because that just provokes it. So
yeah.
Even when you were saying, I say, me and him don't think the same, right?
Yeah.
With that. Because I'm saying to myself already, like, okay, I'm claiming what I want to be. I'm going to put it out there. I'm going to do it, because nobody monopolizes thoughts, right? The thoughts of dominance or the thoughts of success, they open to everybody, right? And the world gives you exactly what you feel you should have, right?
Yeah.
If you believe it, okay, here you go. You know what I'm saying? But when you put it out there, now, okay, did you get up every day and did you treat yourself like you're a bad motherfucker, right? Did you get up every day and did you, for your business, how much did you work on it, right? How did you advertise? Like, even though you're successful, do you still get out there and do the grunt work, right? One thing I did, okay, we're successful from the outside looking in. We don't obviously have as much money as you, but for what we're doing, we're moving forward, right? And so throughout the whole thing, just to humble myself, I moved. Now, I can take this money, go pay a group of guys to move my entire house. My entire house from top to bottom, I boxed it up and moved the whole fucking house just to prove to myself I still had work ethic. I still wasn't a pussy. I still don't mind grabbing shit from the bottom and moving it. I still don't mind moving the box. But what that does is it keeps me fucking hungry and a work ethic out of my ass. So yeah. You try to move a whole fucking house, try to run a family and run a company. Probably isn't the best thing to do, but for me, it conditioned me to do that. But and then get up at 4 a.m. But these are the things that I do to work on myself. You know what I'm saying? I know I'm not talking about anything in particular, but this is just shit that I do to just keep me locked in and keep like saying to myself, you're a bad motherfucker, you're a bad motherfucker. Make sure that you're doing shit that makes you uncomfortable and keep on walking into what is the unknown.
Yeah.
And like even talking to you, I'm like, man, I want to be on this guy's level. And then if I get to your level, I want to be on the next guy's level. And I just think that as humans, we have so much fucking potential, but everything comes down to what the fuck we say to ourselves.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So if I'm waking up saying I don't want to be a pussy, that's not really like, it's not aiming at nothing. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And that was what I kind of inspired. And that's why we did that episode. Was like, well, shit, I just needed to hear someone say it the right way. And then put in perspective what we're saying. Right now, I moved last summer. And I told my wife, I said, we don't need to hire a big fucking moving company. So I sat there and I packed up the house and I moved it like Dennis. We had like with the patio furniture, like 30 things on a truck. I tried to do all these little mini loads, and I hired these one guys with a little van, and I just said, here, just take this. But I did. There was part like sense of accomplishment. Like, I don't need someone to come and do this. But if you ask from my wife's perspective, it was, she's like along the whole way, what the you turned a fucking, you turned 2 days into fucking 3 weeks of complaining. This is ridiculous. But the,
Tell her you were just working on yourself.
Yeah. That's my process.
I like that.
Cool. No, this has been awesome. I mean, I've these guys are all looking at me now like, dude,
shit's gonna go down.
We got no faith in you. Fucking resumes are getting warm. My last thought, which is interesting, is how parallel paths is like you talked about. You and LeBron, when you both were coming out of high school. And I was thinking about it. He's been in the news last week for opening his school, right? And he's probably gotten more, I mean, he's gotten more, I guess, recognition, like universal recognition, right? From his peers, fans of all teams and all this for what he's done with helping kids in the community. And so it's pretty cool that you guys started off on the same paths and then you ended up in the same place, right? And you ended up with more accolades for doing things that help people than you could have achieved from playing a sport. So it's fucking amazing. Like it's an amazing story. And I never thought that when I watched you play at Ohio State, I never thought like one day you'd be holding me accountable on Instagram. And then I sure as hell never thought that one day we'd be sitting here talking on the phone and now I'm fucking even more accountable. So I'm just really I'm excited that you joined the Business and Biceps podcast, so we can get to hear your thoughts and on a regular basis. And honestly, you've been like as inspiring to me as anyone I've listened to or met over the last however long. So
thank you.
It's pretty awesome. So I'm happy that you've all the success you've had and excited to see. What happens next. Now, John is going to claim that you only clean that house because of some new Max Effort muscle product.
Yeah.
I heard on the podcast, he's like, no, you clean that house because you drank the whatever it is, the mushroom tea or whatever.
So he was like, I need you to try these. You're cleaning the house up. So this shit gave me like the most extreme focus like I ever fucking had, right? So I'm dialed in, I'm putting boxes. So I called him up. So it was two times it happened. First time I called him up and I said, yo, my man, I said, this stuff really works, right? The second time I took it like at 6 at night, right? So when I take it 6 at night, I'm up like 3 or 4 in the morning. I can't go to sleep. And so I'm mad at him because I said, yo, dude, now just imagine you up at 3 in the morning thinking about your business. You think about staffing. You're thinking about onboarding processes. You're thinking about services. And I'm happy that I'm thinking, right? And it's clear, but I want to go to sleep because I wake up at 4:30. You know what I'm saying? No. And so, like, I just was like, you should probably put a disclaimer on this stuff that, you guys got to wake up and take this stuff in the morning. But that was it, man. But I'm happy we moved in. I'm happy we're here. Like, it's very cool to even talk to you all on the podcast. You know what I'm saying? I'm happy with life. I'm at peace.
Awesome. Yeah, we definitely appreciate you coming on. And I'm excited to listen to this. And now I got any deal with these guys' thoughts.
you got to put accountability on.
Yeah,
everybody.
And then I'm gonna post more stuff. And then my wife's gonna be like, "Why are you posting so much stuff on Instagram?" And I'll be like, "Cause I gotta fucking
gotta do this." Accountability.
Yeah. So, anyways, cool. Well, I really appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thanks.
All right. Well, y'all brothers have a great day.
You too. Thank you.
Thanks.
All right.
Bye. Amazing. That was fun.
Yeah, that was super fun.
Yeah, the guy is he can literally talk about anything and everything. You can learn something and get something. And I gotta step my game up.
Yeah, Crooks and Goon is gonna launch.
Very soon. Yeah, you gotta stop talking and start doing.
Yeah,
my visualize it.
I'm gonna have to do some
whiteboard it. Just get it done.
I mean, at least I threw myself out there and got told how I could get better.
Yeah,
you just sat there quietly hoping that no one would pick on you.
I was like, I just got to keep quiet and out of the way.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, such great stories. It was awesome.
Yeah.
But I am, however, ready to conquer the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got to quit my job and hopefully put a little bit right here.
It was nice meeting you guys. I'll see you later.
You might be on the wrong podcast, too, because it sounds like some podcasts pay.
Yeah, that's true. That's so weird.
Damn it. Well, I that's where I related with him because I was like, I don't care what it pays, guys. I just want to be in the room with you and just, I want to learn. I figured if I look at you three guys, I'm thinking this is the best place for me.
Yeah.
Silence.
Sure.
Sure, Jim. Sure.
I don't know. We're going to come across as nothing interesting at this point.
Yeah.
That's not true.
No. We just need time to pass so we can be more interesting.
Indeed.
Maurice came in and just kicked all our asses.
Yeah.
I'm sure you could go by, listen to the conversation, just pick out like another 10 topics to talk about on the podcast later on.
Yeah.
That's how good it was. It was good times.
Good times.
So if I was going to follow this podcast somewhere, where would I do that, Dennis?
Speaking of that, what we should do is tell everybody where to follow us. If you have Instagram, which, you know, all of us
will soon be posting much more on.
Follow us at the Startup Addict.
If you want to see when the four of us worked out, from now on, there's a rule. Each of us will post that we finished our workout every day. So we'll see.
All right.
I can no post means you did not work out.
I have a private social network that no one's involved in except for me. Is it okay if I post there?
Nope. It's, you got to start your own now. New one. Brand new one.
Gym at the gym.
Gym at the gym. Gym. Oh. Getting that Twitter right now.
So you're in?
Yeah.
I can. You're in, Julio?
I'll lock that up.
I'll be posting today at 12 o'clock.
Perfect. And then Twitter. Follow us at startup_addict. YouTube. We're going to be soon getting a URL, which I'm excited
for.
Yes, we are. It's coming.
It's coming.
Yes, we are. So if you want to find us on YouTube, search The Startup Addict. And then, of course,
subscribe. So you'll be putting us one step closer to our own URL.
Yes, please do that. And then also thestartupaddict.com. And we have a Speed Quarters event next Saturday.
Next Saturday. Well, coming up this Saturday.
August the 11th.
Today, August 11th. By the time this posts, today will be Monday.
What day is today?
Right? So this weekend.
So this weekend.
The premiere of the Win Club Wales.
Yes.
The Win Club Wales will be at...
In attendance.
Cannot
Speed Quarters
wait.
SQ4.
That's going to be super fun. All right. Well, I guess thanks for listening. And goodbye.
Bye.